All right, good morning, guys. All right, we're gonna dive right in. A couple of things as we get going, though. This is text heavy because we're gonna be looking at some of the tradition, and the tradition is at least partially instantiated in texts, so it's up there. I don't have a handout for this one, but I've asked AJ afterwards to send this PowerPoint out so you don't have to worry about missing anything or frantically taking notes. This is kind of my Eucharist 201 talk. So this is not the introductory Eucharist real presence talk. We're not going to march through John 6 like every apologetics talk on the Eucharist. This talk presupposes that. This talk presupposes our understanding of the real presence. I thought in a setting like this, that would be appropriate to take it kind of to the next level. So this is a little more advanced. We're going to dive a little more deeply into the tradition. Hopefully, you'll hear some things differently than you've heard them before, perhaps some things that are new and that you can apply. So we're going to do a little bit of apologetics, defending specifically the Mass as a sacrifice, the sacrificial nature of the Mass. Some apologetics. A little bit of sacramental theology. That's what I do. So you've unknowingly wandered into a theology lecture. And then we'll do a little bit of application to how we participate in the Mass. It's about 3 hours worth of material in 50 minutes. So we're going to dive right in. So if we talk about the Mass as a sacrifice, we have to talk about that reality first. And it's helpful to realize that we can talk about the Mass in this twofold way. Or we can talk about, I should say, the Eucharist in this twofold way as both sacrament and sacrifice, this twofold understanding of the Eucharist. And we can understand it in this twofold way and analyze it using different conceptual tools. So the sacrament and sacrifice of the Eucharist are performed by the same act of consecration. We're talking about one reality, one act at Mass, but it can be considered distinctly as sacrament and sacrifice. Here's what St. Thomas Aquinas says about this. This sacrament is both a sacrifice and a sacrament. It has the nature of a sacrifice inasmuch as it is offered up. There's a dynamic action happening, an offering up. And it has the nature of a sacrament inasmuch as it is received, say in Holy Communion. And therefore, it has the effect of a sacrament in the recipient when we receive it at Mass, the Eucharist. It has the effect of a sacrament. What's the effect of a sacrament, right? Gives grace. And the effect of a sacrifice in the offerer. Who's the offerer of the Mass? Yeah, we're going to get there. It's not just. There's more, right? We'll talk about that. And in them for whom it is offered, for those present, for those to whom that Mass is applied, and indeed for the whole world. So just the idea here, this beginning idea, is we can consider the sacrament as both sacrament and sacrifice. We can understand it that way as well when we talk about the twofold end. As a sacrament, the Eucharist is directed immediately towards our sanctification. In receiving the Eucharist, it's directed immediately towards making us holy, filling us with the life of God, with grace. As sacrifice, it's directed immediately to the glorification of God. This is right, sacrifice is about worship. So we've got this twofold end of the Mass, the glory of God. Our sanctification, which is the twofold end of all of liturgy. And we can consider these differently because, as a sacrament, the Eucharist is an enduring reality. It is the real presence. It perdures after the celebration of the Mass in our tabernacles, in our churches. There's an abiding presence. As sacrifice, it's a transient action, it happens at Mass. And it's over in 1 hour, right? So as sacrifice It's this momentary action as sacrament. It's an enduring presence. Now, it's going to help to have some understanding of why we believe this. So here we get into a bit of the apologetic piece. Why would one hold that the Mass is a sacrifice, has a sacrificial character? And we're going to want to start with Scripture. The Catechism actually tells us about this in paragraph 1365, that the very language of the words of institution are in the Gospels already sacrificial. Just the way Jesus institutes the Eucharist at the Last Supper, he uses language that is charged with sacrificial overtones. The Catechism says, the sacrificial character of the Eucharist is manifest in the very words of institution. This is my body, which is given for you. That language of given, right? Not simply given to you to receive, but given for you. In order to be given to the disciples, Christ's body had to be given for them in sacrifice. In the Old Testament, a victim had to be immolated before it could be consumed ritually. It had to be given for in sacrifice before it could be given to in participating in that ritually. So the very language of given for you, right, is sacrificial. And this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. That language of poured out. This is the language of the Old Testament for the blood of a sacrifice that is poured out before the altar. So the Catechism says, in the Eucharist, Christ gives us the very body which he gave up for us on the cross. That language, gave up for us on the cross. The very blood which he poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Even that language of given, right, given for you. In the Old Testament, the expression to give can refer to the portion offered to the Lord in sacrifice. This is in Numbers 18:12, by the way. Numbers 18:12, the portion that's given to the Lord in sacrifice uses the same verb here. The portion given to the priests and the Levites to consume, to give. Leviticus 10:14. So underlying all of this language of the body given, right? The blood poured out is sacrificial language. There's even more allusions to this as well. Let's put this all up. That's a layer down because we don't read Greek and we don't know the Greek Old Testament. Old Testament's written in Hebrew, translated into Greek. That would have been the version our New Testament authors used. And so in the Greek, there are all kinds of allusions that we don't pick up on when it comes into English. So for instance, in Matthew 26, which is part of the institution of the Eucharist, the Last Supper, Jesus talks about his blood and says, this is my blood of the covenant. And this is a direct allusion to the sacrificial blood that sealed the covenant at Sinai in Exodus 24. When the people say, we will obey all that God has commanded, Moses says, behold the blood of the covenant and sprinkles it on them. The point being, the blood was sacrificial blood, and now Jesus is taking that same language and now applying it to the blood he's giving at the Last Supper. It's sacrificial in tone. And then he says, do this in remembrance of me, Luke and 1 Corinthians. And it sounds in English like we're just getting a command to repeat the sacrament. But again, underlying this in the Old Testament allusions is language of sacrifice. The do there in the Greek, do or make, is sometimes used in the Septuagint, the Greek Old Testament, for offer. Exodus 29, Leviticus 9, Psalm 66. In those verses where it talks about offering a sacrifice, it's the same verb used in the Greek for what Jesus says, do. Do this in remembrance. And remembrance, even more, remembrance or memorial, again, for us in the 21st century, remembrance memorial is something that's gone and passed and we just think about it now. But that's not the Hebrew mind for remembrance or memorial. Remembrance or memorial makes a reality present. And it's also in the Old Testament often a sacrificial term. Exodus 20, Leviticus 2, Leviticus 24. There are certain sacrifices that are memorial sacrifices. The sacrifice is offered in remembrance. So all this language of given and poured out and do and memorial remembrance is all charged with sacrificial overtones. There are other places in the New Testament where we see this as well, at least references perhaps to the Mass as a sacrifice. Paul talks about the Eucharist in 1 Corinthians 10 and 11, and he compares the Eucharist, or he gives an analogy to the Eucharist with pagan sacrifices at the altar. So here's what he says. Consider the practice of Israel. Are not those who eat the sacrifice partners in the altar? When in the Old Testament, you took part ritually by consuming a part of the sacrifice, you're a partaking in the sacrifice. You're a partner in it. What do I imply then? That food offered to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? So now he's comparing it to pagan sacrifices. What if you eat meat sacrificed to an idol? You go to the marketplace and you eat meat that had been sacrificed to a pagan idol. Are you partaking of that pagan idol? Right? He says, no, I imply that what pagans sacrifice, they offer to demons and not to God. I do not want you to be partners with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You see that little move he made there? On the one hand, you have sacrifices offered to demons that would make you partakers of those demons. On the other hand, you have the cup. What's he speaking of? The Eucharistic cup, which by analogy would be a sacrificial cup. Sacrifice to the demons on the one hand, partake of the demons. On the other hand, the sacrifice of the blood of Christ, partaking of that. This kind of parallel shows a sacrificial understanding of the Eucharist. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Right? It's one or the other, but they're both sacrificial. The other indication we have is in the letter to the Hebrews. We have an altar from which those who serve the tent, the Old Testament worship, the Levitical priesthood, have no right to eat. So the question is, what altar was the letter to the Hebrews speaking about? There's not a whole lot of context here, but it makes sense, given everything we've talked about, that he's referring to the Eucharistic altar. And what happens on an altar? Not a picnic, right? Picnics happen elsewhere. Altars are for sacrifice. So these would be some of the New Testament foundations for the sacrificial nature of the Mass. As you move out of the New Testament into the early church, this is universally and immediately recognized that the Mass is a sacrifice. Immediately in our earliest documents, and no one is denying it. No one's denying this for the first Christian millennia, at least. At least. So I only have a few examples because we could kind of multiply these ad nauseum. But the Didache is from probably the year 100 at the latest. The Didache is contemporaneous with some of the New Testament writings. It's an instruction on how to live as the church. It's a church order. The Didache, St. Justin Martyr, around the year 160, gives a description of the Mass, very similar to our Mass today. St. Irenaeus, around the year 190. We're not even out of the second century yet. And then the great giant of the West, St. Augustine, in the fourth and fifth centuries. All of these figures, notice how early and consistent, all make reference to the prophecy of Malachi 1:11 as fulfilled in the Christian celebration of the Eucharist. When each of these figures gives their account of how Christians worship in the Eucharist, they all point explicitly to Malachi 1:11 and saying, that's what's going on. This is Malachi 1:11 happening for us. And y'all know what Malachi 1:11 says, right? So I'll put it up. For from the rising of the sun, even to the going down of the same, of the sun. We used to say in the Eucharistic prayer, from east to west. Now we say in one of the Eucharistic prayers, from the rising of the sun to its setting. That's where this comes from. What's the rising of the sun to its setting? What does that mark? Day, time, so at all times. But it's also, it is east and west, right? In all places. From the rising of the sun, even to the going down, all times, all places, my name has been glorified, look, among the Gentiles, the nations, not necessarily among the Jews. This is a Jewish prophet writing to the Jews. And he talks about, at all times and places, the Lord being glorified among the Gentiles. And in every place, incense is offered to my name. That's sacrificial language, isn't it? Incense offered to my name. And a pure offering. For my name is great among the Gentiles, says the Lord Almighty. The early Christians looked around, especially once the temple had been destroyed in the year 70, and they said, where is the prophecy of Malachi fulfilled among us? Where is there at all times and places, not just in the temple, but among all of the nations, not just among the Jews, but among all the peoples, where is a pure sacrifice offered to the Lord? And they said, it's on our altars. It's in our Eucharist. Right? So it was very natural for the early Christians, each one of these figures, to point to their Eucharist and say, here it is. Here's the fulfillment of Malachi 1:11 as a sacrifice is being offered to the Lord. We get some explicit testimony, for instance, from St. Ignatius of Antioch, beginning of the second century, 110. This is someone who knew the apostles. He says, make certain, therefore, that you all observe one common Eucharist. For there is but one body of our Lord Jesus Christ, and but one cup of union with his blood, and one single altar of sacrifice, even as there is also but one bishop with his clergy, and my own fellow servitors, the deacons. Right? So, very explicitly, what is the Eucharist? It's a sacrifice offered on the altar of sacrifice. You start to see, right, this very consistent, immediate and consistent testimony that the New Testament was understood and the Eucharist was celebrated as a sacrifice. A little bit later, we'll jump for another great testimony to the year 350 to St. Cyril of Jerusalem. Now, Cyril is the bishop in Jerusalem, and in this context, he's giving instructions to those who were just baptized at Easter. At this point in the church in Jerusalem, they would not explain ahead of time what would happen during those rites of initiation. They would wait until the person was baptized and confirmed and received the Eucharist, and then the bishop would explain it. And here's part of what he says about the Eucharist in the year 350. Then, having sanctified ourselves by these spiritual hymns, we beseech the merciful God to send forth his Holy Spirit upon the gifts lying before him, that he may make the bread the body of Christ and the wine the blood of Christ. For whatsoever the Spirit has touched is surely sanctified and changed. Then, upon the completion of the spiritual sacrifice, the bloodless worship, over the propitiatory victim, the victim offered for the forgiveness of sins, talking about Christ on the altar under the appearance of bread and wine, over that propitiatory victim, we call upon God for the common peace of the churches. So in offering the sacrifice, now they're offering it in prayer, in petition for certain prayers they have, for the peace among the churches, for the welfare of the world, for kings, for soldiers and allies, for the sick, the afflicted. And in summary, we all pray and offer this sacrifice, all who are in need. This first part, to wrap up this first part, the notion that the Mass is sacrificial in nature is implied in the very words of institution. It's alluded to in the New Testament. And then when you read the early testimony of how the church worshiped, it was immediately and consistently understood as a sacrifice. But we can take it one step further, and this is what the tradition did. It started reflecting on that systematically. How? What does it mean to call the Eucharist, the Mass, a sacrifice? How is that the case? How is the Mass related to what happened on Calvary? What's the relationship there? And for that, we're going to turn to St. Thomas Aquinas. So he says, he asks this question, how is the Eucharist a sacrifice? And he says, the celebration of this sacrament is called a sacrifice for two reasons. First, and he's going to quote the great master of the West, Augustine. He says, first, because as Augustine says, the images of things are called by the names of the things whereof they are images. And then he gives an example, as when we look upon a picture or a fresco and we say, this is Cicero and that Sallust. Not sure who that is. So in the first instance, Thomas Aquinas points to the Mass and says, it's a sacrifice first insofar as it's an image of Calvary. Well, we're going to have to get to that. Well, how? That's the next question. How is it an image? This is what he says next. The celebration of this sacrament is an image representing Christ's passion, which is his true sacrifice. So we're going to have to unpack that. How is the Mass an image of the sacrifice of the cross? But he says, because of this, accordingly, the celebration of this sacrament is called Christ's sacrifice. So this is his first of two reasons. He says the Mass is a sacrifice because it's an image of the sacrifice of Calvary, but it's more than that for Thomas. He goes on to say, secondly, it is called a sacrifice in respect of the effect of his passion. Not only is it an image of the passion of Christ, but it's going to apply the fruit of that passion of Christ here and now. So he says, because by this sacrament, we are made partakers of the fruit of our Lord's passion. What happened so long ago, 2,000 years ago, on the other side of the world, how does that become subjectively applied to me, 2023 in Wisconsin? Thomas is going to say it's through the sacrifice of the Mass. It's first an image of Christ's passion, but then in an even more realistic sense, the fruits of that passion are applied to me here and now. And so then he actually quotes a prayer from the liturgy, which is still used today. Hence, in one of the Sunday secrets, we say, whenever the commemoration of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is enacted. When the image is made present, the fruits are applied here and now. The Council of Trent picks this up, and it's going to repeat Thomas, and it's going to amplify Thomas. So in explaining the sacrifice of the Mass, the Council of Trent in the 16th century, and this is one of the things that was quite specifically responding to the Protestant reformers. This was one of the main things that, beginning with Luther, was denied across the board by the Protestant reformers, was that the Mass was truly a sacrifice. And so Trent repeated the tradition and then also amplified it. So it said, Christ, our Lord and God, was once and for all to offer himself to God the Father by his death on the altar of the cross, to accomplish there an everlasting redemption. So we have the passion of Christ historically, 2,000 years ago. But because his priesthood was not to end with his death, at the Last Supper, on the night when he was betrayed, he wanted to leave to his beloved spouse, the church, a visible sacrifice, as the nature of man demands. We need a visible sacrifice as a body-soul unity, by which the bloody sacrifice which he was to accomplish once for all on the cross would be re-presented, made present again, its memory perpetuated until the end of the world. That's Thomas's image, right? It's a memorial, it's an image. And its salutary or saving power be applied to the forgiveness of sins we commit daily. That's Thomas's applying the fruit, right? So it's a memorial image that applies the fruit here and now. But then Trent is going to add a little bit more. It's going to draw out the elements that make the sacrifice of the cross and the sacrifice of the Mass one and the same sacrifice. So in the sacrifice of the Mass and the sacrifice of the cross, the sacrificial victim and the primary sacrificing priest are identical. Only the nature and mode of offering are different. Here's exactly what Trent said. For the victim is one and the same, right? The victim on the cross is Christ. The victim on the altar at Mass, the one being offered, is Christ. The same Christ, now offering by the ministry of priests, who then offered himself on the cross. So the primary offerer at Mass is Christ. Same victim, same priest. On the cross, he offered himself. At the Mass, he offers himself first through the ministry of priests. This is why priests, ordained priests at the Mass, at that very particular moment, slip into the first person singular. This is my body. This is my blood. The manner alone of offering being different. On the cross, in a bloody manner, and in the Mass, in an unbloody manner, in what we call a sacramental manner, under the appearance of bread and wine. We're going to fast forward several centuries to Pope Pius XII, 1947. And Pope Pius XII, in an encyclical on the liturgy, repeats all of this tradition and then adds to it. He gives a great summary of what's come before and then, again, adds to it and amplifies. He says not only is the priest the same, not only is the victim of the same, but he also says the ends are the same, the reasons for which the sacrifice is offered. He says that the appointed ends, the goal, the reason of the sacrifice of the cross and the sacrifice of the Mass are the same. And he names four. Why did Christ sacrifice himself on the cross? Same four reasons as the sacrifice of the Mass. One, for the glorification of God. Two, in thanksgiving. Three, in atonement, for propitiation of sin. And four, for appeal, or the word he uses is impetration. It's intercession, petition, right, to ask for what we need. Here's a good summary from the current Catechism of the Catholic Church, paragraph 1367. The sacrifice of Christ and the sacrifice of the Eucharist are one single sacrifice. And then it explains, using the language of Trent, the victim is one and the same. The same now offers through the ministry of priests, who then offered himself on the cross. Only the manner of offering is different. And since in this divine sacrifice, which is celebrated in the Mass, the same Christ who offered himself once in a bloody manner on the altar of the cross is contained and is offered in an unbloody manner, this sacrifice is truly propitiatory. It really is for the forgiveness of sin. It's of the same value as the sacrifice of the cross, right? It applies the same fruit. all of this should make sense of the language that so surrounds our Catholic worship. We have an altar. In the history of world religions, altars are for offering sacrifice. Noah got off of the ark, and he didn't build a picnic table and have lunch. He built an altar and offered sacrifice. We have a priest, not just a minister or rabbi, because in the history of world religions, priests offer sacrifice. Even when we go receive the Eucharist, we Catholics use the word host, yes? The ciborium is full of the hosts. You with me? What does the word host mean? In the context of the Sanctus, the Holy Holy, the heavenly hosts is an army of angels. Not in this context. This is one of these things, this is like worth the cost of admission. Because Catholics, we say this all the time, right? If you're an extraordinary minister of Holy Communion, I'll take the hosts. But what does host mean? Do you know the hymn, O Salutaris Hostia? Who knows that one? I should try to sing it. O Salutaris Hostia. I shouldn't try to sing it, right? It's used at adoration, benediction. Do you know the translation of O Salutaris Hostia? O saving victim. When we host is from the Latin for victim. When we say we receive the host, we're saying from the Latin we're receiving the victim of the sacrifice. Let's talk about the nature of this sacrifice. So that's a lot of the what. Let's do a little sacramental theology and see a little bit more if we can understand the nature of this sacrifice. The first thing we can say about the sacrifice of the Mass is that it's a relative sacrifice. It's relative insofar as it's related to Calvary. It's not a sacrifice simply in its own right, but insofar as it is connected to what happened on the cross. So Paul kind of even references this in 1 Corinthians 11, where he says, as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. The primary thing is the Lord's passion, and relative to that is our eating the bread and drinking the cup, is our sacrificial Eucharist. And so we can say this, that in the sacrifice of the Mass, Christ's sacrifice on the cross is made sacramentally present, that is, under the guise of signs and symbols. That's what we mean by sacramentally, under the guise of signs and symbols, like under the appearance of bread and wine. In the sacrifice of the Mass, Christ's sacrifice on the cross is made sacramentally present, its memory celebrated, its saving power is applied. So you see, the primary thing there is the sacrifice of the cross. And then relative to that, we have the sacrifice of the Mass. The sacrifice of the cross, we can say, is an absolute sacrifice. It exists in itself. The sacrifice of the Mass is a relative sacrifice because it's essentially linked to the sacrifice of the cross, making it present as a memorial and application. And hence, the sacrifice of the Mass, therefore, in no way detracts from the sacrifice of the cross, on which it depends for its power and the fruits it applies. So notice this somewhat resolves the problem of seemingly sacrificing Christ over and over and over again, which we don't do and we don't hold, we don't believe. That Christ's sacrifice in the absolute sense is once and for all in a bloody manner on the cross. What's repeated is not Christ's historical sacrifice, but the sacramental representation, which is only a relative sacrifice connected directly to that absolute sacrifice. We can understand this sacrifice further by noting that it's both an external and internal sacrifice. It has both an external and an internal element. It has to be both, because if the sacrifice is only external, this is the great critique of the prophets in the Old Testament, that your lips are paying me service, but your hearts are far from me. Both represent, represent, makes present again, 100%, And it represents, it's an image, like St. Thomas and Trent said. Those two in sacramental symbolism go together. That which represents makes present again. That help? Cool. Yeah, this external and internal, the external needs to be completed in an internal offering as well. So the external sacrifice in the Mass consists in our outward sacramental rite that happens on the altar and the signification that's brought about by the virtue of the words of consecration. It's the ritual that happens on the altar. And we're going to specify that in a moment even more clearly, what specifically that is. But in addition to that, Christ is still offering himself as an act of the will to the Father. There corresponds an inner act of oblation. When you see oblation, offering. There corresponds an inner act of oblation in which Christ offers himself in obedience and love to the Father as a sacrificial gift, just as he offered himself in the voluntary giving of his body and blood on the cross. So in the Eucharist, you have the coming together of these two. You have a sacrificial ritual on the cross, on the altar, but which is coupled with Christ's ongoing self-gift to the Father, this external and internal. Now, we're going to get really to the heart of it, the essence of the sacrifice of the Mass. Right? We said with Thomas Aquinas and with the Council of Trent that one of the ways that the Mass is a sacrifice is that it is a representing image. We added to that, but that's at least one way. We said that in the Mass, Christ's passion and cross are sacramentally present. Well, sacramentally means under the guise of signs and symbols. So we want to ask this question: what part of the Mass, what constitutive part of the Mass is the sacrificial action properly so called? If I go into a Mass and I watch what's happening on the altar, in the ritual, under the guise of signs and symbols, what would tell me that that is a sacrificial action? You're absolutely right. Why? We're going to go one step deep. Yes, 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 yes. Yes, one step deeper. Yeah. He said consecration, and we're going to land right there. Because after the Council of Trent, which affirmed so strongly that the Mass is a sacrifice, the question was this: how? And there were a lot of theories going around. Well, what happens to a sacrifice? A sacrifice is something that's destroyed. It's called the immolation. So maybe it's when the priest consumes the host. It's immolated. It's destroyed. Maybe it's the fractioning, right? And Pope Pius XII settled this matter in his encyclical, going back to Thomas Aquinas. The essential action consists in transubstantiation, in the consecration. Through consecration, you have transubstantiation. What do you have through transubstantiation? The body and blood of Christ. With me so far? But there's that and. They're separated on the altar. Specifically, it's the double consecration of the elements of bread and wine into the body and blood of Christ that represents in a sacramental manner, that is under the guise of signs and symbols, the real separation of the body and blood of Christ, which took place in the sacrifice of the cross. So, right, what happened to Christ on the cross? His blood flowed from his body. He poured out his blood in death. The separation, really, of his body and blood. And then on the altar, we have the consecration, but it's a double consecration. We have Christ's body, we have his Christ's blood separated. This is a sacramental image of his real separation of body and blood in the altar. Pius XII says it better than me. Here's what he says in his encyclical. For by the transubstantiation of bread into the body of Christ, and of wine into his blood. His body and blood are both really present. That's the real presence, right? Now the Eucharistic species, the appearance of bread and wine, under which he is present, symbolize the actual separation of his body and blood, which happened on the cross. So he says, Thus, the commemorative representation of his death, which actually took place on Calvary in a bloody manner, is repeated in every sacrifice of the altar, seeing that Jesus Christ is symbolically shown by separate symbols in a state of victimhood. There's our key there. The separate consecration shows under the guise of signs and symbols Christ in a state of victimhood, his body separated from his blood. So the essence of the Mass here, this double consecration, right? There are these different theories, and they come together in what Pius XII talked about. Oblation theories really emphasize the offering piece, and this is Christ's inward act of oblation. But since the act of sacrifice also requires an outward sacrificial act, which manifests the inward act, the essence of the sacrifice of the Mass requires the sacramental separation of his body and blood effected through double consecration. So this is going to bring us to our final piece. I know I'm racing, but this is actually maybe gets us to some of the more important part. Our role as laity in offering the sacrifice of the Mass. Now I'm going to have to, for sake of time, bypass some of the stuff I prepared, but I'll give you the really quick version. All of this is based on our participation in Christ's priesthood through our baptism. And that I would have established with you from Scripture, that 1 Peter talks about the entire people being a holy priesthood that offers spiritual sacrifices. He calls all of us a royal priesthood. And he borrows language, by the way, from the Old Testament, which talks about all of Israel as a priestly people. And then Israel surrendered itself as a priestly people. When? When did they lose their universal priesthood? Yeah, the golden calf incident. And who became the priests? Why? They didn't. They slayed all of those who worshipped the golden calf, right? And so they that day became the priestly tribe. Peter's talking here about reestablishing God's people as a priestly people, offering spiritual sacrifices. This is what Paul talks about in Romans. He appeals to the Romans by the mercies of God to present your bodies, your very selves, as a living sacrifice. So there is in the New Testament this priestly people. We all share through this through baptism. In fact, at our baptism, the priest says, just as Jesus was anointed priest, prophet, and king, so may you live always as a member of his body, sharing everlasting life. There's two shares in the one priesthood of Christ. Christ is the one priest of the new covenant. There are two sharings in that differ in essence and not only degree. So there is one sharing that is the ordained ministerial priest that has a very specific function in the new covenant. And then there is a different share, the share of all the baptized through our priesthood. This is a document, Lumen Gentium is the Second Vatican Council's document on the church. Look at that second bullet point, because it specifies in the sacrifice of the Mass what is unique to the ordained priest. It says the ministerial priest, by the sacred power he enjoys, teaches and rules the people. Acting in the person of Christ, he makes present the Eucharistic sacrifice and offers it to God in the name of all of the people. When it comes to the consecration that makes the sacrifice present on the altar, obviously only the ordained priest does that. This is the primary sense of the sacrifice, right? But then the document goes on to, I didn't even have it up there when I was reading it. You got to tell me that. There it is. Then it goes on and says, but the faithful, in virtue of their royal priesthood, language from 1 Peter, join in the offering of the Eucharist. They likewise exercise that priesthood in receiving the sacraments, in prayer and thanksgiving, the witness of a holy life, by self-denial and act of charity. But our point here is, that the laity join in offering the sacrifice of the Eucharist. In another place in that document, it's going to specify what we do in our baptismal priesthood. What does that look like? And it says, for all their works, look at the breadth of this. This is for us, laity, all their works, prayers and apostolic endeavors, their ordinary married and family life, their daily occupations, their physical and mental relaxation, if carried out in the spirit, and even the hardships of life if patiently borne, all these become spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. This is the language of 1 Peter, offering spiritual sacrifices. What is that? Lumen Gentium, the Second Vatican Council, tells us it's the whole web of our daily existence. There's nothing in our lives that could be left out of what we can render to God in thanksgiving. But then it says this, together with the offering of the Lord's body, that is the Eucharist, they, all of these spiritual sacrifices, are most fittingly offered in the celebration of the Eucharist. Thus, as those everywhere who adore in holy activity, the laity consecrate the world itself to God. So God has given each of us a small sphere of influence in which we are affected and affect others. And our job is to take all of that and render it in thanksgiving to the Father, who's given it all to us. But that's most fittingly done with the celebration of the Eucharist. There, we want to turn now to the liturgy. In another document from the Second Vatican Council on the liturgy, it tells us what it desires for the laity when we attend Mass. The Church, therefore, earnestly desires that Christ's faithful, when present at this mystery of faith, the Mass, should not be there as strangers or silent spectators. On the contrary, through a good understanding of the rites and prayers, they should take part in the sacred action, conscious of what they're doing, with full devotion and collaboration. Right? Good understanding of the rites and prayers, full devotion and collaboration. Got to wonder, how are we doing, right, as a church? But then it's going to specify that even more. What is it we're supposed to collaborate with? What in the first place is our participation in the Mass? They, the laity, should be instructed by God's word and be nourished at the table of the Lord's body. They should give thanks to God. By offering the Immaculate Victim, capital I, capital V, not only through the hands of the priest, but also with him, they should learn also to offer themselves. Notice there's three ways this happens. This is our participation in our baptismal priesthood of offering the Eucharist. One, through the hands of the priest. Two, with him or in union with him. And three, by offering ourselves. What does all of that mean? We can back up about 16 years to Pope Pius XII, who in his document on the liturgy told us, this is where it all comes from, Pope Pius XII. He tells us, first of all, we've got to get straight that when it comes to the words of consecration, by which Christ is made present on the altar in that state of victimhood, that's done by the ministerial or ordained priest alone. But then what about our participation? Remember, in union with the priest, right? Let's see. This one. So he says, that's what I skipped. He says the same thing as the other document. They not only offer the sacrifice by the hands of the priest, but also in union with him. But then he explains that. Here's by the hands of the priest. Pius XII says, this is 1947. Now it is clear that the faithful offer the sacrifice of the Mass by the hands of the priest from the fact that the minister at the altar, the priest, in offering a sacrifice in the name of all his members, represents Christ, the head of the mystical body. Hence, the whole church can rightly be said to offer up the victim through Christ. The idea here is that the church forms one mystical body, and Christ is the head. And so when the priest at the altar offers the sacrifice as head, the body comes along for the ride. This is a passive participation. I participate in the offering simply by being a member of the mystical body of Christ, which is conducting it through her head at the altar. But there's more. In union with him, He says, the conclusion that the people offer the sacrifice with the priest himself is based on the fact that the people unite their hearts in prayer, impetration, asking for what we need, expiation, for forgiveness of sins, and thanksgiving with the prayers or intentions of the priest, even the high priest himself, Jesus. So the idea here is now not a passive participation, but an active participation. Now through an act of the will, through the movement of prayer, I join myself in what's going on in the altar. So at the moment of the offertory, I might pray something like, Father, I offer you all the good that I have done, the evil I have endured, in union with this sacrifice of the Mass offered upon the altar of the cross in atonement for my sins and the sins of the world. Act of the will. I'm joining with what's going on in the altar. I teach my little kids. I have an 8-year-old and a 5-year-old. My oldest is Lucas. I teach him just to pray, Jesus, I give you myself. Right? He's placing himself on the altar at that moment. And then Pius says, let them also offer up themselves. It's therefore desirable, he says, that all the faithful should be aware that to participate in the Eucharistic sacrifice is their chief duty and supreme dignity, and that not in an inert and negligent fashion, giving way to distractions and daydreaming, but with such earnestness and concentration that they may be united as closely as possible with the high priest, Christ. And together with him and through him, let them make their oblation, their offering, and in union with him, let them offer up themselves. And then this is just a wonderful quote. He says, in order that the oblation, the offering of the Mass, in order that the oblation by which the faithful offer the divine victim in this sacrament to the Heavenly Father may have its full effect, right? In order that the sacrifice of the Mass may have its full effect, it is necessary that the people add something else, namely the offering of themselves as victim. If we're not doing that, the Mass is not bearing all of the fruit in our lives that it's intended to. He says, nor should Christians forget to offer themselves, their cares, their sorrows, their distress, and their necessities in union with their divine Savior upon the cross. And so Pius says we need to become a victim. While we stand at the altar, then it is our duty so to transform our hearts that every trace of sin may be completely blotted out, while whatever promotes supernatural life through Christ may be zealously fostered and strengthened, even to the extent that, in union with the Immaculate Victim, we become a victim acceptable to the Eternal Father. If we're to offer ourselves as victim at Mass, the victim that we offer ourselves should be of the highest value and quality possible, which means that it has a moral component. Right, that we root out sin in our lives and offering the very best we can. I'm going to close with this because Pius XII also talks about how this idea of our participation in the sacrifice of the Mass is just manifest right in the words of our liturgy. When the priest prays, may pray, brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God. There's an identity, but a distinction. The priest is offering by consecration, by the act of transubstantiation, but we bring our spiritual sacrifices and unite them to what's going on by the hands of the priest and in union with him. And then just the language, think of Eucharistic prayer 1. The priest prays, for them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves. That's talking about our participation. Or a little bit later, we, your servants and your holy people, the plural we, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim.